Wonderful writer, producer, actor, and founder of the Classic TV Preservation Society. It's a nonprofit organization dedicated to the positive influence of classic television shows. Over the years, Herbie has graced our store with his new books, educating and entertaining our customers with wit, wisdom, energy, and expertise in all things pop culture. On behalf of Barnes & Noble Burbank and our wonderful customer base, please accept our gratitude and appreciation for bringing pop culture to our community-centered store tonight and every Thursday through the end of July. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, here's Herbie J. Pilato.
Thank you very much, Jane. Hello, everybody. Welcome. I'm very excited about this. What's neat about it is that I've been talking about classic TV and classic media for 40 years, and I'm sure you all have as well. And I've been reporting about it and actually meeting some of the people that I've admired and I've loved. And one of the things that I've tried to do with my books, the Bionic book, Glamour Gidgets and The Girl Next Door, the Life Goes On book, and my two biographies about Elizabeth Montgomery, is that I tried to not so much write it from a fan's perspective, but from a mainstream perspective. And they're not exploitive books and they're not gossipy books because I felt that went against the whole message of what I was trying to present. So in doing these books over the years, I started giving seminars to schools and colleges and community centers and senior centers and businesses talking about the positive influence of classic TV and all classic media. And that became very popular, so I automatically decided, well, I've got to formalize that in some way, and that's when I came up with the Classic TV Preservation Society, which is a formal 501c3 nonprofit organization that really goes throughout the country or wherever I'm requested to talk to schools and to talk about how Father Knows Best from the 1950s, the great TV show, or the Donna Reed show, or any show that has transpired in any decade over the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and up to 2000s. So I just combined it all, and I'm here today, and every week this month in July, we're going to focus on one particular decade in pop culture, classic television, classic movies, as well as what we were all doing while we were watching those shows in pop culture in general. So I have a couple guests tonight, special guests. And the first guest is someone that I've known for quite some time. And I'm going to pop over to this table here and read you just how wonderful a human being and talented a man this gentleman is. Joel Eisenberg is a writer and producer whose new book series, The Chronicles of Ara, an epic 8-volume fantasy saga co-authored with Stephen Hillard, has been released to rave reviews by Topaz Books, an imprint of Incognito Publishing. Joel is a partner in Eisenberg Fisher Productions and the former head of Emo Films at Paramount Studios. He is the co-founder of All Cities Media, an entertainment industry network group. His events have been hosted by Warner Brothers, Paramount Studios, and Sunset Gower Studios, among others. Joel is the screenwriter of several award-winning independent feature films, and is the producer of a slate of past and upcoming motion pictures and television projects, including Mirkwood, based on the Amazon.com bestseller and the aforementioned The Chronicles of Ara fantasy novel series. In early 2007, Joel was fortunate to have received substantial international publicity by locating, identifying, organizing, and archiving a long-considered lost handwritten John Steinbeck archive, collectively valued at nearly $1 million. Joel is also the author of How to Survive a Day Job, Championship Networking, and more. Joel also happens to be a massive fan of the sci-fi fantasy pop culture genre. I love saying that word, genre. Which is certainly took off in the 1950s on television with shows like The Twilight Zone, and we have a special guest later on from that show, we had a guest appearance, and with feature films like It Came from Outer Space, The Thing, Them, the original War of the Worlds, and so much more. Ladies and gentlemen, Joel Eisenberg.
Thank you everybody for coming. Mind if I sit?
No.
Awesome. All right. So, I paid Herbie to read that because my wife was sitting over there and I wanted to look really good in front of her. So, Lori, I hope it worked. I'm tremendously important, just in case you didn't know. Thank you, Herbie. That was a nice introduction. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
As Herbie mentioned, my name is Joel Eisenberg, and I'm a writer. What I want to do, and this is what I typically do when I do these types of events, is I like to get to know who I'm speaking with. Because I'm a guy, you don't necessarily know me. I'm sitting here, I could talk. But I want to know what you do. So instead of me like doing this, I'm going to ask, does anybody here like movies? Okay. Does anybody here like TV shows? Okay, now I'm going to start pointing. You have your hand up really high. What's your name?
Marcello.
Marcello? What's your favorite TV show? That's my favorite too.
Yeah.
What's your second favorite TV show? Oh, that one.
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else?
Leave It to Beaver.
Hey.
Are you really? Wow.
I wasn't expecting
that. Wow. Now, he didn't, like, speak to you before this. Wow, I am shocked. That's great. I love Leave It to Beaver.
He's funny.
I love Leave It to Beaver. Why do you find him so funny?
I don't know, you
kind of
act like me.
Now I'm trying to decide if that's scary or not. So, okay, I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Could I ask you, what's your favorite TV show? And what's your name?
Carmen?
Carmen, I'm sorry. And what's your favorite TV show?
Twilight.
Okay.
Twilight Zone.
Twilight Zone? Now I knew I liked you for a reason. Because we're talking 1950s tonight, right? And I see in the window that I'm a pop culture expert, but my one weak decade is the 1950s. I was born in 1964. However, the Twilight Zone and the person that created the Twilight Zone, Rod Serling, have had major influences on me and my career. Now, I see this gentleman here who is agreeing with that statement. You're a Twilight Zone fan. No? Okay. So here I am.
Not yet.
Okay. I'm trying to play the crowd. And sometimes you fall on your face. Okay. Twilight Zone is a great show. I love that show. Who else? You have a favorite TV show?
I got one.
Yes.
Life of Riley.
Which one? William Bendix or Jackie Gleason?
William Bendix.
Okay, that was, I used to watch William Bendix's A Life of Riley every day back in the 1970s when it was repeated on WOR Channel 9 in Brooklyn, New York, which is where I'm from. Anybody else here from Brooklyn? Okay, I'm really from California. Okay, maybe not. What a revolting development this is.
Oh, Susanna,
I'm not familiar with. Amos. He is.
Oh, yeah, that's a Gail Storm, correct?
What's that?
Gail Storm?
No.
No?
No.
Ann Southern.
Oh, Ann Southern is Oh, Susanna.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's one show. Bob Cummings had the Calendar Girls.
Love that, Bob.
Which
became the Bob Cummings Show.
Exactly right.
Yeah. Remember Amos and Andy?
Oh, sure.
Okay, yeah.
Sure.
So, that's just a few.
Well, I'd see, history was just made because Herbie J. Pilato could not answer or identify one of your shows.
Which one did I answer?
No. As far as who was, you said Ansa.
Yeah.
Did you say Gale Storm first?
I said Gale Storm first.
That's what I'm talking about.
So we were playing password.
Herbie Pilato made a mistake. It's historical. All right, moving on. But thank you for that. Thank you. Anybody else? Favorite TV shows? Yes.
I like, Perry Mason.
Perry Mason, Raymond Burr. Why do you think, I'm just kidding, what was your name?
My name is Bruno.
Bruno.
Yes.
Okay, now my favorite professional wrestler back in the 1970s was named Bruno Sammartino. So I can remember Bruno.
I know Bruno Sammartino.
Who knows Bruno Sammartino? You do?
Yeah.
Do you know him personally?
No, I know. I'm
you know who
very
he is.
Familiar with that name.
Okay. Yeah. Bruno was the best at the time. Why do you think Perry Mason lived on as it did? Why do you think it had so much influence?
It's a good question. I think the show was on for about nine seasons,
like that,
right?
Because of the intense drama.
But let's say, for argument's sake, other shows have also had intense drama.
I think...
Why this one so long?
I think it was real. I mean, you really believe he's a lawyer. And
okay.
He never looked like he's acting. He always
Perfect.
Looks like he's the real thing.
Perfect. Okay.
What about the creepy music at the beginning?
Now, you were just loaded with surprises. First, Leave It to Beaver, and now a Perry Mason fan?
Wow.
Is this... Were you born in the 1950s? Or
maybe.
So, you watch this on MeTV, I'm assuming.
How about the Donna Reed?
No, it's... I'm watching it.
The
and
Donna Reed show.
His bedroom is not far from the living room.
And so
he hears all the...
Okay. Do you like the music?
At first it creeped me out, but like and then as he kept watching all the time, I got used to it. I'm like, I got used to it.
Okay. So you like 1950s TV?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, what I think one of the reasons why Perry Mason was so well done, and why any television show or film that is well done is well accepted, is it was based on novels, a series of novels, mm-hmm. which later became. A radio show, which then transferred into a TV series.
Okay.
So. But there's also another. There's also another reason why I think people love it.
What
is
that?
It looked like cinema. If you look at that show, it really looked like a 1950s black and white movie. Mm-hmm. The production values and the look of the visuals. It looks like. Maybe a B movie, but it's
yeah,
really well made.
Yeah, I know what you mean by that. I know what you mean, and it was shot in black and white.
Black and white.
And to you, it looked like it was a feature film as opposed to a television show.
It doesn't look like something cheap, like a cheap TV show. It looks like a really, really well done, well written, and well produced film.
Are you in the movie business?
No. I'm just I appreciate good cinema and good television.
Very interesting. Very interesting. That was an interesting answer. Anybody else? Favorite movie or TV show?
The first TV show I can remember seeing when I was very young was I, Mary Jo.
Okay.
In black and white.
Okay.
Remember that one? You're too young.
Well, so you're, well, technically I'm too young for Twilight Zone. Very nice meeting you, by the way. Too young for Twilight Zone, too young for a lot of this that we're talking about. However, what I was raised on, and I know we're supposed to be talking about the 1950s, but I was raised on Universal horror films of the 1930s and 40s. In New York, we used to have a show called Creature Features. And so every weekend, I was watching Boris Karloff and Lon Chaney Jr. and Bela Lugosi and Glenn Strange. Are you familiar with Frankenstein and Dracula, the Wolfman and all?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
The characters, I don't know about the films.
Okay, well, that was a perfectly good question. Who is familiar with the old black and white films? Okay, a lot of you. Okay, Beaver, did you watch it?
Yeah.
Okay. If I ever see you in the street, I have to call you Beaver. It's just one of those things. 1950s, let's go back to that decade. Any other, anything? Who here is a fan of Twilight Zone? Okay. Let's get into Twilight Zone for just a minute. For me personally, my all-time favorite television writer is Rod Serling. My second all-time favorite television writer is Stephen Jay, the late Stephen Jay Cannell, okay, who wrote one of my all-time favorite TV shows called Wise Guy back in the 1980s.
Rocket Files.
Exactly, and he did the A-Team and a bunch of shows. But Twilight Zone. Twilight Zone was incredibly influential, not just to me, but to so many people that have gotten into the movie business or the TV business or the writing business. So my question to you is why? What was it about Twilight Zone? Not so much the same question I asked before about Perry Mason and its longevity, but why does a show like Twilight Zone, do you think, inspire so many people to get involved in creative careers? Can anybody answer that?
Well, I think that...
Now, by the way, Herbie, if you have the wrong answer, you're disqualified.
I think the answer is very similar, really, to what we were talking about with Perry Mason on several different levels.
Okay.
Again, Twilight Zone was based... those scripts were many times based on little short stories. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So there was always a good story base first. Okay. Then it came out in the 1950s when science fiction was, in general, very popular. But there was always a moral to each episode, correct?
Exactly. And let me go that one step further. The comic books were from the 1950s, but the television show was from the 80s and 90s. Does anybody here remember Tales from the Crypt?
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Who here was a fan of Tales from the Crypt? Who here just did not care about Tales from the Crypt or never watched it before?
Never watched it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Tales from the Crypt was based on a series of comic books in the 1950s of that name. EC Comics was the publishing company that put out Tales from the Crypt, Vault of Horror, and so on. There was a character called the Crypt Keeper that became very popular on TV in the 80s. The reason why EC, and they were crazy horror stories, not science fiction, they did have a science fiction, they had science fiction titles, but for this purpose, Tales from the Crypt was horror. And they all had morality lessons. So you read these stories, and they're very extreme, but you learn these lessons. Like, can I ask you a question? Okay. What grade are you in?
I'm fourth.
You're in fourth grade?
Yes.
Okay, I was in fourth grade when I was your age.
Okay.
I know, that was bad, right? Okay, I gave it a shot. Okay, so you're in fourth grade. How do you do in school? You do okay?
Yes.
What's your favorite class?
Math.
Math. Why?
Because I can add stuff.
Okay. And you feel that when you do that, you're learning and you're using your brain and you're getting smarter? That's totally fair. So let me ask you, is there anything on television that you like that has to do with math? Just curious. Okay, if not, it's okay. Here's my point. Some of the reasons why these shows last that we're talking about is because it speaks to a person. They speak to people, like if someone's interested in science fiction, Twilight Zone speaks to me because I'm a huge science fiction fan. Tales from the Crypt spoke to me because I like smart horror. And Tales from the Crypt had morality lessons in addition to all of its extreme gore and horror and scariness. And when I hear, for example, you're into math, I was wondering if there were any TV shows that were math related that maybe you watched. I have to ask you the same question. Do you have, what grade are you in?
Ninth grade.
Now, Beaver, calm down. Okay, ninth grade. I'm just kidding. What's your name?
Naomi.
Naomi, and what was your name?
Andy.
Andy. Okay. Naomi, what's your favorite class?
Beaver.
Am I putting you on the spot?
Yes.
I know I am. Herbie history. Said yes.
Huh? History.
History. Do you like any television shows that have anything to do with history or any movies that have anything to do with history?
Um, I kind of like watching National Geographic.
Okay. And so that has an influence on you. So if National Geographic was on the television, you'll watch it, and then after that show is over, do you think about it? Okay, that's fair. And so much of 1950s TV or 1960s classic television, 70s and so on, it's the exact same thing. It leaves you with a certain kind of feeling. Shows like The Brady Bunch, you know, which is, again, I'm not 50s.
We can't talk about
going this, okay. I have to gear back. By the way, cut me off because I'm from Brooklyn and I talk a lot. So you can tell me to like change the subject and I will, like he just did. But here's the thing. Shows last because they have impact on the viewer. And typically what happened, for example, with me, I used to watch The Twilight Zone constantly. Anybody here, some of the older people, remember Playhouse 90?
Yep.
Okay. Specifically, does anybody remember Requiem for a Heavyweight?
With Jack Palance.
With Jack Palance and then Anthony Quinn for the feature film. Requiem for a Heavyweight was about an old broken down fighter. That was the story. He falls in love. That was it. Very simple. Rod Serling wrote it, the same guy that wrote Twilight Zone. It blew me away. I became a huge boxing fan from watching Rod Serling's Requiem for a Heavyweight. So when I went to high school, I figured I'd be a boxer. I took boxing. I lost my first fight, got a bloody nose. That was it. True story. Yes.
What about Muhammad Ali?
Muhammad Ali has always been one of my favorites.
Okay, good.
Okay. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
When did he have his first fight?
Well, I don't recall when he had his first fight, but he beat Sonny Liston in the early 1960s.
In the early 1960s?
In the early 1960s, okay. I believe it. I have to look that up, but he was Cassius Clay at the time before he was Muhammad Ali.
Yeah, Cassius Clay.
Huh?
Oh, no, I was just saying I forgot the name Cassius Clay.
Let me give you a little bit of my background, because I could do this and we could talk, and I don't want to bore you. We have, you know, several people here. My background... I was a, and tell me as I'm saying this, if any of you relate to this, when most of my friends growing up were playing football and baseball and basketball, I was in my bedroom watching monster movies on TV, reading Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine, my favorite magazine of all time, started in 1958. So again, we go back to the 50s, even though I was born in 64. My influence was prior. There you go. And
what is that?
The Year of Bewitched.
Oh, Bewitched, that's when it started?
Elizabeth Montgomery.
I see.
And so what happens is, it's interesting because I was watching a lot of classic TV. So Herbie, who is the author of these books, this is my childhood right here. I could extend my right arm and look at Herbie Pilato's books and say, this was my childhood. And by the way, this is unsolicited, and it's not 1950s, but excuse me. Whenever I'm in a place with Herbie, I have to say this. This is the single best pop culture book I have ever read in my entire life, and I put that review on Amazon.com, the Bionic book. So if anybody is into the $6 million man, the Bionic woman, don't buy that book, I'm only kidding. Okay. So, I used to build models. I didn't want to do what the other kids were doing. I didn't want to play sports. I wanted to stay home. I wanted to write. I wanted to read. And I always wound up going back to the Tales from the Crypt comic books. And I always wound up going to Twilight Zone. And then I started watching Father Knows Best. Again, more 1950s. And I started just anything that was on for the 1950s in black and white. My favorite at the time, which was very interesting, outside of Twilight Zone, was a segment on the Mickey Mouse Club called The Mystery of Applegate Treasure. Mm-hmm. Do you remember?
No.
You don't remember The Mystery of Applegate Treasure?
I do not.
The Mystery of Applegate Treasure was the first television appearance of the Hardy Boys.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay. And it was my favorite segment of the Mickey Mouse Club. So I'm watching this, I'm like, all right, get past the singing and the dancing and all that stuff. Give me my Mystery of Applegate Treasure. And it was just, this stuff just made me want to be a writer. I was so inspired. So when I went to school, I didn't like, this is why I was asking you the school questions, there was a point to it. I personally didn't like to read a lot of what I was, a lot of what I had to read. I appreciated it years later. that you really do, if you have a teacher that said, and I used to be a teacher, if you have a teacher that says, well, read this, you may say now, I don't want to do it, I don't want to read it, it's boring. Trust me, teacher's doing the right thing. It pays off later, it really does. You're not going to be aware of that now. So let me just get that out of the way. So I was that kid. I didn't want to read at the time what my teacher wanted me to read. And I was flunking out. I was flunking out at sixth grade. Here I was, I thought I was all brilliant and everything because I was getting really interior and asking really tough questions as a kid. And I'm like, okay, you know, what does this mean? What's the meaning of this? What's life, death, the nature of the universe? All this stuff. And I was like 7, 8 years old. So I'm flunking out of sixth grade and I say, you know, to my parents, they're going to have me repeat. And I was tremendously embarrassed, and I couldn't really, I had a real hard time gearing up to tell them this. So my dad and my mom went to my teacher, and they made her a deal. They said, let me ask you this. If my son could read a book and do a book report on something he wants to read, as opposed to something that he has to read, and he passes that, would you advance him to the next grade? The teacher said, sure, can't cheat, etc. Turned out I got an A+ on that report because I read a book I wanted to read. The book was called The Haunting of Hill House by Shirley Jackson. It was a horror book. And there was a movie back in the time period called The Haunting. And Lori, you had mentioned it earlier today.
And they redid it?
They redid it back like 15 years ago.
Yeah.
My friend Gil Adler was a producer.
With Eddie Murphy?
No, that was something else. That was a Disney Haunted Mansion
deal.
So I passed, I advanced. And the long story short is, okay, I wanted to write. This is what I wanted to do with my life. So what did I do by the time I went to college? I majored in special education.
I'm going to come join you for a second.
Because
it's a good segment, of
course. Okay. Which has nothing to do with writing. But I felt I had something, I needed something to fall back on. And so I had my education career. I did it for 10 years.
Well, no, I want you to talk a little bit about your book.
Okay.
And how, you know, the 50s culture or 50s films might have inspired that. I know that when I read it, and my review of his book is on Amazon.com as well, I really was so impressed that I compared you to like Gene Roddenberry. So talk a little bit about how that book came about, and how you were inspired to do it, how possibly maybe the 50s culture inspired you to write that.
No, I refuse.
Okay.
No. Thank you for that. The answer to that, basically just Reader's Digest condensing the rest of this, is I kept writing because I was so inspired by all those TV shows that we were talking about. And I kept asking those tough questions like I used to ask when I was a kid because I was obsessed with difficult answers. And I started writing, and I started selling, and things were happening. And then things stopped, and I moved back to New York, and I went back to being a teacher. I moved out here in 1989. I was a school teacher in New York for about 5 years. Came out here, taught a little bit, was doing some writing, stopped, went back to New York for 2 years. As soon as my feet hit the ground, I felt like I gave up on my dream. My dream, ultimately, was basically to write these books. This is one of eight. This is an 8-part series. This first one just came out. Second one comes out in October, and there are some spin-offs in between. So there are 8 books in the Chronicles of Aura series. And the long and the short of it for me is I had to go through all of these peaks and valleys and all of these movements and all of these kind of sideways journeys to get to the point where I could sit in Starbucks every morning at 5 o'clock, peanut butter on a bagel and 2 cups of coffee. Yesterday my wife yelled at me, she said, you're 51 years old, you can only have 1 cup of coffee now. So at 5 o'clock in the morning it's now 1 cup of coffee as of literally this morning.
And one bagel.
And one bagel and peanut butter because, you know, it's like before when they were taking the pictures, I had to do this because whenever I take a picture and I'm wearing white. Anyway, it looks like I'm fat, that's what I'm saying. It looks like I am.
You're so fine.
Heavy set. Thank you. I'm not politically correct. I'm sorry. I'm from New York. Here's the deal. I come from a heavy set family.
Available bookseller to customer services.
The
please.
Thing of it is this. Use the inspiration that 1950s television holds for you. Use the inspiration that television today holds for you. For me, you mentioned a bunch of movies in that nice introduction, thank you, but you didn't mention my all-time favorite science fiction film of the 1950s, which is...
Forbidden Planet.
No? The Incredible Shrinking Man.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wow.
Okay, we have some Incredible Shrinking Man fans based on the response. Awesome, awesome. So that's my all-time favorite 1950s science fiction.
Which was remade.
But for The Incredible Shrinking Woman by Lily Tomlin. But the thing is, you know, from there it's just a lot of reading. So some guys that are in school, keep reading. You know, this is when it all pays off. You'll start discovering new worlds. You'll discover new things outside of where you are right now, and that's what I did. These books are wild. And, you know, there's a lot of thought. There's a lot in here in science fiction, fantasy, and basically what it is, in a nutshell, is taking all of these obsessions that I'm running on about, and how inspired I am by art, and books, and movies, and TV. And what if there was, like in Greek mythology, there was a muse, but there's only one in these books. There was a muse who inspired all of art and creativity. That's our muse. And in these books, she's corrupted. So if the muse is corrupted, then that means all of our art and all of our creativity is corrupted, and there is a reason for it. There's an end game. Where does it all lead us? It's like when people say Grand Theft Auto is bad for kids, or this movie is not good for you. In the 1950s, it was the same thing. These books will cause juvenile delinquency. Tales from the Crypt, don't read them. They took those Tales from the Crypt comic books from the 1950s, and they burned them in bonfires. Okay? There was a psychologist by the name of Frederick Wortham that said these comic books were bad for kids. And that caused a whole big thing that led to a Senate subcommittee hearing on juvenile delinquency, that comic books were causing kids to cause too much trouble, to rob stores, to do everything bad, and they're saying it was based on the comic books. Okay, that was a hysteria back in the 1950s. So I took all that and I put it in this series. And science fiction, fantasy, 8 books, and we go on a very big journey that encompasses the worlds of art, and we follow some of our greatest creators, literary creators, on their journeys. Like J.R.R. Tolkien and Edgar Allan Poe, H.P. Lovecraft, Mary Shelley, who created Frankenstein. They're all characters in these books. So I hope you enjoy it. And what other questions did you have?
Well, I would like to talk just a little bit about the Twilight Zone thing again.
Yep, yep.
Because I had worked about 15 years ago, I worked on a show called Psyography, which was a science fiction version of the Biography series. And I was living in Rochester, New York. And I got the job because I lived close to Binghamton, is where Rod Serling was from.
Right.
And I had the chance to interview, believe it or not, his kindergarten teacher.
Wow.
In 1999. So she was like 97 or something.
Okay.
He unfortunately passed away very early. So we went to his hometown, we went to his college, which I think was Ithaca College.
Okay.
And we were taking shots of his awards and all his scripts. And I remember walking into this one archived area and opening the door and seeing all of these shelves of scripts. It wasn't just the Twilight Zone, he did Playhouse 90, so just an amazing mind. So I was backing up, you know, to direct the camera in or whatever, to get a good shot, and I hit the table, and a script fell off. So I picked it up, and guess what the title of the script was?
I know.
Do you?
Yeah, I'm going to take a wild guess.
What is it?
Planet of the Apes.
Herbie.
Oh.
And all I saw, it was kind of, it was an amazing, amazing moment. I don't know what it meant.
Wow.
And I actually looked it up,
yeah.
You know, to see, I think it was from like a Playhouse 90, and, but I wanted to, you know, take it.
Yeah.
Of course, I did not, and I probably could have asked if I could have made a copy of it.
Well, see, that's interesting, because to me, and the reason why I said Planet of the Apes, how many people here knew that Rod Serling also wrote the screenplay of the original Planet of the Apes. Okay? Okay. One of my favorite movies of all time. So now, with me, it's like, okay, so this guy who wrote The Twilight Zone, and now we're veering into the wrong decade.
Yes, we are.
Okay, so he also wrote Planet of the Apes. Now we're going back into the Twilight Zone days. To me, there is no more consistently well-written television show in the history of TV than Twilight Zone. I think in terms of writing, in terms of consistency, and I believe you were in a Twilight Zone episode,
yeah.
Correct?
The Fear.
Okay, The Fear. Very cool, very cool.
Well, I think, Joel, fantastic. What an incredible speaker, what an incredible mind, incredible talent. We will be signing both our books at the end of this evening. An hour or so. So please stick around and talk with Joel some more and meet in person.
Thank you.
Well, our next guest is a very, very incredible individual that I've had the pleasure of knowing these last few years. Name any television program of any worth that ever aired, and Peter Mark Richman has appeared on it. Measure any scene in any TV show, motion picture, or play in which he ever performed, and he's hit his mark with precision. In fact, there are not enough numbers in the decimal system to properly calculate the number of times Peter Mark Richman has delivered the goods of his vocation. On television alone, his impact is astounding. From his early TV days on anthology shows like The Armstrong Circle Theater, Alfred Hitchcock Presents, The Outer Limits, The Twilight Zone, through the 1960s on his own classic series Kane's Hundred, to action-adventure shows like The Man from U.N.C.L.E., It Takes a Thief, on into the 70s on detective shows such as Longstreet, on which he had a regular role, Beretta, Barnaby Jones, Charlie's Angels, through the 1980s with Heart to Heart, Knight Rider, Dynasty, Star Trek The Next Generation, and on into the 1990s with Beverly Hills 90210 and beyond. Whether voicing God or playing Suzanne Summers' minister father on Three's Company, whether voicing an animated Spider-Man or confronting the $6 million man, Richman has done it all with class, sophistication, and elegance. A few of his most cherished memories are from working on the anthology shows from the Golden Age of Television, such as Playhouse 90, United States Steel Hour, and the Philco Playhouse. We are honored to have him here this evening to talk about it all. Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Mark Richman. You can either have a seat or stand whichever you prefer, Peter.
Did I do all those?
You did all of them. Every single one of them.
Just so I can keep it straight, I'm going to put on my glasses and refresh myself. My professional acting career began in Philadelphia on a show called Papa Pietro's Place, a black and white TV soap opera that went on the air in the late 1950s to 51. It was networked on the East Coast and broadcast from the studios of WPTZ and NBC affiliate. And in case you didn't know, I'm a registered pharmacist too. In New York and Pennsylvania, I was working as a manager in a pharmacy in Rosemont, Pennsylvania when I got out of college. And I was doing leading roles in community theater when I got an offer to be an actor in a summer theater, so I quit pharmacy and went to work as an actor and never returned to pharmacy. Thank God. It was my first professional theater job in 1952 in a stock company called the Grove Theater in New Angola, Pennsylvania, where I met my wife. She was leading lady, and I became the leading man. We got married the following year and moved to New York City.
Helen Richman.
This was the beginning of the so-called golden age of television and blossoming of fabulous writers like Patty Chayefsky, Reginald Rose, Ted Mozell, and Rod Serling. My first TV role in New York City was on Studio One, a period drama with Ava Gabor. The realization that you are on live TV and millions of people are watching you across the country, for any actor who has never done it, it's the first time, can freeze your toenails. I began studying with Lee Strasberg in his private classes. I then auditioned for the Actors Studio and was accepted as a member. Lee Strasberg's classes were cauldrons of creativity. He was a master, and I was grateful to be there witnessing his scholarship and his genius. My stage work continued with summer stock roles in Mr. Roberts, first at the Westchester Playhouse in Mount Kisco, New York, with Russell Knight, and then in Rochester, New York, with Wayne Morris. Then back to Mount Kisco and to appear in Detective Story with Eddie Binns, Martin Balsam, and Werner Klemperer. In 1953, I did my first off-Broadway show, End as the Man, by Calder Willingham. It was an Actor's Studio production with Ben Gazzara, which premiered at the Theatre de Lys in Greenwich Village, and then moved uptown to Broadway. Later, Jack Garfine directed the film called The Strange One, starring Pat Hingle, Ben Gazzara, and myself. The Actor's Studio always had attracted high-profile celebrities from Hollywood and Europe to sit in on the classes, but one particular visitor was causing more than a stir. There was a glow around Marilyn Monroe that wasn't imaginary. She would join a group of us at Child's Restaurant and after class, including Eli Wallach and his wife Ann Jackson, Tony Franciosa, myself, and a few others. Marilyn began studying with Lee Strasberg, and this was the beginning of her evolution as an actress and her maturation. In 1954, I was leading man in a summer theater in Gooseville, Pennsylvania, with Tom Bosley and Eileen Ryan, who later married Leo Penn and gave birth to Sean Penn. I began to do more live TV, starting with Philco Playhouse, directed by Arthur Penn, and starring Lily Darvas. This was my first major role in a prestigious network television show. I then worked with directors Franklin Schaffner, Robert Mulligan, and the wonderful Delbert Mann, who directed me in Patty Chayefsky's Middle of the Night with Eva Marie Saint and E.G. Marshall. I somehow started to get cast opposite stars who were a bit older. I did 4 United States Steel Hours, first a drama called The Shame of Paula Marston with Ann Baxter and Gene Raymond, the second called The Hour Before Dawn with Teresa Wright,
playing her husband, and Colleen Dewhurst. Third one was An Act of Terror with George Grizzard. Then I did Partners with Luther Adler, a wonderful actor. And then I did, we had a sympatico relationship playing father and son. Following that, I did two shows for Play of the Week, Emmanuel with Lois Nettleton and George Siegel, and Thérèse Raquin with Oliva Le Gallien. Around 1956, live TV in New York was dying a slow and gurgling death. They began flying actors from New York to California for series TV. So I became a commuting thespian. They called me to the West Coast for the June Allison show with June and Ann Harding, the Jane Wyman show opposite Margaret O'Brien, two Alfred Hitchcocks, The Cure with Nehemiah Persoff, and Man with a Problem with Gary Marshall and Elizabeth Montgomery. Then I flew out to do a Playhouse 90, directed by John Frankenheimer, called The Last Man, starring Sterling Hayden. I guest starred in the very first Rawhide with Clint Eastwood, directed by the erstwhile Richard Worf. My stage work continued with a Broadway show called Masquerade, starring Glenda Farrell. I suggested Cloris Leachman to play opposite me and was pleased when she got the part. It was the beginning of a long and wonderful friendship. I also did Zoo Story off Broadway, Edward Albee's first play in which I starred in 400 performances. The most challenging stage work was playing the lead role of Johnny Pope in Hatful of Rain. I went into the play the last 2 months of the Broadway run and then toured with the National Company opposite Vivian Blaine and Harry Gordino. It was on the set of Playhouse 90 that I got a call from the director, Marty Ritt, who wanted me for a movie called The Black Orchid, starring Anthony Quinn and Sophia Loren. I'll never forget the first time I saw Sophia walking towards me. I can only think it was like a panther coming my way. She was something else. I would tell my wife about her. She didn't appreciate it. She was pregnant with our first child.
Still doesn't.
Finally, it was back to New York until I moved to California in 1961 to star in my own series called Kane's 100. I was Nick Kane. I'm going to read a few excerpts from my autobiography relative to the 1950s. It's called I Saw a Molten White Light. I was on a popular drama network television show and it boosted my career to another level. What riveted me, my concentration, and drew everyone's attention to the screen were those long, lingering close-ups of this cop, which I played, compassionately studying the old lady, Lily Darvas, trying to figure out what to do with her. In rehearsal, I had discovered a way to use something Lise Strasberg had said. It was a simple and basic truth in acting. When you look at someone, really see them. See how long their eyelashes are. See the pores in their nose. How deep the wrinkles are in their forehead. I seriously did that on television, and it was right for the part, and it caused a stir because Arthur Penn kept cutting to my face and dwelling there for my reactions. Suddenly, I was a new young actor that was wanted, and the parts kept getting larger and more attention getting, and the activity breeding more activity. I worked with Delbert Mann on the television version of Paddy Chayefsky's Middle of the Night. We would all sit around a table in some sterile rehearsal hall and read the script and see how the words sounded to the author. We had about 9 days to put it together before airtime. One day, I remember saying a line and Paddy Chayefsky stopped the reading. Wait. That doesn't sound right. What would you say, Peter Mark? For an instant surprise, I looked at Paddy's inquisitive, intense face, and on the spot, from somewhere within me, I hesitantly came up with a line. Keep it. It sounds good, Paddy said. This situation occurred many times with writers such as Reginald Rose, Tad Moselle, Rod Serling, Horton Foote, or whomever the writer happened to be that particular week. With director's approval, most writers were receptive to suggestions or dialogue changes. This privileged opportunity as an actor gave me an indication that I had a facility to write and express believable dialogue. It remains one of my stronger points as a writer. I was thumbing through the paperback edition of Best Television Plays of 1954, edited by Gore Vidal, and I saw that a show I appeared in was listed, Man on the Mountaintop, by Robert Allen Arthur, won the Sylvania Award that season. Arthur Penn again hired me to play a key role. Also in the cast were Ann Mira, who just passed, and Stephen Hill. It was executive produced by Fred Coe, who became an icon of the golden age for his guidance of quality television. I was appearing regularly on television in one show and another, and my name was getting known, developing the reputation of being a good young actor who could deliver. In another Goodyear Playhouse, this time with my friend Jack Klugman, we were clogging our way through the camera blocking process and NBC Studio 8H on the 8th floor of Rockefeller Center. Jack kept shaking his head, both of us laughing, sharing the peculiar circumstances of my life and how it was turning out. He couldn't get over the fact that I went to pharmacy college, got my degree, and licenses. And now I was married and a working actor working with him, two guys from South Philly. During the lunch break, I was walking through the black marble hallway to Cromwell's drugstore when I ran into Jimmy Dean. We shook hands and chatted. I can still see his bespectacled face, all smiles and twinkles, about flying out to Hollywood to begin shooting his first film, East of Eden, with Kazan directing. He was really excited, like a little kid opening birthday presents. He'd made a splash in a new play on Broadway called The Immoralist, and this would be his first film. He had no idea what a huge star he would become. We shook hands again and shared a friendly hug as I wished him good luck. I walked away thinking, my God, Hollywood, I wonder what that must feel like, going out there to never land to star in a movie. It was when I was touring with Eva Marie Saint in The Rainmaker that I got word that William Wyler was interested in me for the film Friendly Persuasion. Friendly Persuasion was to be the big one for Allied Artists and the Mirisch Brothers. It was a major step upward with the $3 million budget, enormous at the time. A few days before we started shooting, I was sitting at a long table in a studio office room, ready to read through the script. Willie Wyler, ever warm and smiling, greeted everyone as they entered and pointed to a chair at the table. There was a hush. When Gary Cooper walked in, the icon of the industry, tall, erect, with a slight gimp from too many horse falls, a wave of his hand and a shy, self-conscious smile on his face. Then he sat down next to me. After the introductions by Wyler, he reached out his hand for a shake. I loved the man instantly. I had seen him 100 times on the screen, sympathetic, steely-eyed, and heroic, and now here he was in the flesh. Wearing a dark blue sports jacket, white shirt, and a gray tie, your friendly, gentle, unassuming major star. I sat there fingering my script as I looked around the table, feeling privileged and grateful to be among such accomplished screen talent. I never thought seriously about myself in Hollywood. It was like thinking about going to the moon. The idea was too far-fetched. Dorothy McGuire, sitting opposite me, was a very fine actress. She had a sweet, open face and distinctive, lilting voice. We developed a close relationship and remained friends all through the years. I felt that I could talk to her about anything, and sometimes I did. She played Cooper's Quaker minister wife and was lovely in the part. Anthony Perkins, who played Cooper's son, was long and lean with bony shoulders that had the appearance of a clothes hanger being stuck in there somewhere. He was a very handsome, gifted young man. Phyllis Love sat close to me. She had a lovely face, big eyes, and a unique cleft in her chin, and photographed divinely. A member of the Actors Studio also, she was playing Mattie, the Quaker daughter, in love with me. She was supposed to be about 16. I think that concerned her a bit. But in the film, I thought she pulled it off with flying colors. Wyler was a perceptive observer as a director, always open to what the actor brought, never missing anything. He had uncanny ability to feel the scene as it was being played, to cry or to laugh in his involvement. He couldn't tell an actor how to get where he wanted him to go, but when he got there, he printed it. Marjorie Maine was a treat, younger and more vital than I could have imagined, with a voice that growled. Her character, a dissy farm woman with three daffy daughters, when she said her lines just sitting at the table, she was already a full-blown character as big as life, and Weiler giggled and laughed loudly. It was heady stuff being in a room full of memorable legends. Of course, I cannot forget one other remarkable participant sitting in the room, reserved and quiet and intimately involved, Jessamine West. She was a delightful freckle-faced Quaker woman and an important American writer. She had written the screenplay we were about to shoot based on her book. We had an instant rapport, and she sent us an inscribed first edition of every book she ever wrote from the time we met. Gary Cooper was an impressive gentleman. When you were with him, you couldn't help but feel the history of motion pictures emanating from his every pore. At first, it was a little disconcerting. Every look, smile, voice change, or gesture had been experienced by you in a huge magnifying presence. It took a while to get used to the smaller image. And then he was like a brother, a warm friend, at least to me. I will never forget the times he would take me to lunch. I would be walking down the street at Allied Artists in my Civil War uniform, and he would pull up in his silver Bentley, roll the window down, and say, "What are you doing for lunch?"
I can hear that in my head as he was saying right now. He would patiently wait a few minutes while I hurriedly changed in my portable dressing room, grabbed a shirt and dashed back. Then we were off to the renowned Brown Derby on Hillhurst near the studio to settle in for a couple of hours in a secluded booth. Private moments with one of the most famous and respected men in the world. To say that it was an honor to be with Coop is an understatement. It
was
a
fun. I want you to cash out.
What?
No.
It was fun and a real joy. He was just who he was, and that was it. I always felt he enjoyed my company too. He was very conversant on a wide array of subjects and far from a yuck man. My only regret is that I cannot remember a quarter of it. I have often thought it would have been great to have had a hidden recorder, not to deceive, but just to remember those times. He told me that he always regretted that he'd never been on the stage and envied the kind of experience I'd had in the theater. Can you imagine that? He was so charmingly humble. How do you learn all those lines and repeat the same performance every night? He asked, as if that was something he could never do. He also said that he was impressed with the work that they were doing at the actor studio. He knew that Phyllis Love and I were members and liked our performances in the picture. At that particular time, it so happened that the actor studio was on a fund drive, and I had been asked to pitch in. I didn't want to be too pushy, so I gingerly said, smiling to her, cover the push. Coop, would you like to contribute to the good efforts of the Actors Studio? There was a pause, and then he seriously answered, would $5,000 make me a member? Thank you, and I'll take your questions.
Gosh, where do you start?
$5,000 in those days, that was probably $50,000 today, right?
Yes, $5,000 in those days was like $50,000 today, right?
Yes. He was a terrific man, Coop. I will never forget him. He was one of those actors that I turned around to see. He was so impressive. And a wonderful gentleman.
Is he the Hollywood actor that had the biggest impression on you?
Yes, because He emanated shyness and confidence at the same time. He was enormously satisfied with himself, and not that he was egoistic. He was who he was. And it was very impressive. He was statuesque. I loved it.
That's great.
I remember my wife and I were invited to his home, and he showed us the gun collections, and Mariah was there, his daughter. She was about 19, she married that pianist.
Byron Janis.
Byron Janis, who had a problem with his muscles in his career. And he retired, I think.
Did he have an extravagant lifestyle for all the money that he had? The house he lived in, the kind of car he was driving? Could you tell? Or do you think he was, I don't know? What I mean is, do you think he was downplaying all the fame and the money that he had? Or was he living exactly at his level?
I think it the home was not ostentatious. I remember a tree going in the living room. That's the first time I saw that. And yes.
So was there any roles that you auditioned for that you really wanted and you didn't get?
Many.
Is there any that come to mind as far as movie roles or TV roles?
For 35 years, they call my agent and they want Peter Mark Richman, and I didn't have to audition for roles. But when I was a younger actor, feeling my oats, as they say, I didn't get many roles. And I wondered why, But that's the way the business crumbles.
But then you got a bazillion after that.
Yes.
Because it was your time.
Yes. Yes.
The easier question, is there any role that you passed and you regret having passed? When I say passed, that you did not take and that you regret? That you can remember, that you don't remember?
No.
Well, you...
I'm trying to ask him a question. Wait, no.
Oh.
Have you noticed that with the onslaught of classic television like TV Land or Nick at Night or even MeTV, that you can be seen 4 or 5 times a day? I mean, I've seen you, I saw you on the Twilight Zone the other day shooting the giant spaceman with your single gun. You know, I could see you as Chrissy Snow's, you know, Reverend Father. I can watch pretty much any of those classic stations anytime during the week, and there you are. So, along with the people like Lois Middleton and the other actors and actresses,
I was fortunate to do over 500 guest star roles.
Right.
And a couple of series, Ten Dynasty and
Long Street
and
Three's Company.
I forgot. That's what.
You can forget.
Right, but you just see that the genre now is really promoting people like yourself that had a lifetime success of acting, and you know, you're very recognizable because you did so much work, and a lot of the people that you work with that you mentioned are the same way. So the onslaught of classic television has brought a resurgence of people like yourself and reminded everybody what a prolific career you've had.
Yeah,
that's
true. Well, one of the great things about Peter and... Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just curious if you've ever gone back to the Strasbourg studio as a guest teacher, or are you still involved with it at all?
I didn't hear you.
Have you gone back to the Lee Strasbourg studios as a guest teacher? I know they have guest teachers into the classes.
I monitored classes.
Explain, there's an Actor Studio West.
Yeah, and I Actor Studio West I go to, and occasionally I do New York, and I several years ago I monitored the classes and made comments. Yes.
Given all the technological changes and advances that have occurred over your career, which would you say presented the greatest challenge to you in adapting to it?
Acting is acting. On the stage, you have to project. In the films, you have to reserve expression. More is enough. Don't go overboard. And an experienced actor knows that. Because I'm from the stage, and it's a good training no matter what the medium is.
Yes, one of the things I wanted to mention about Peter's life and career is that he is a well-rounded individual who has had, obviously, this incredible career, and yet he has managed to, you know, stay married to the same lovely woman and to have, how many children do you have, Peter?
5.
And I was just, I have, you know, several blogs, and some of you are on my email list, my obsessive compulsive email list. And I talked about this recently, about the most important thing, you know, that a person can do for their career, whatever it is to live their life. And you're not attached to your career, and you just go and you live your life first. And, you know, you're just such a prime example, a perfect prime example about having such a full life and really making your life first and your career second, and as a result, you've never stopped working. So I mean, I just have so much respect for that. And there are a few others that, you know, I know of, and that I've studied in our industry, who have that same philosophy, I guess you could say, and I just have a great deal of respect for it. I'm sure we all do. So I just wanted to come.
I'm very grateful for to God for all my talents and the writing came from acting, and I have a play now running in Israel for 2 years. In July, it will be 2 years, and it's a major hit, and it's called A Medal for Mary, and we went 2 years ago to Israel, translated into Hebrew, and it's amazing how that thing happened. I was doing a scene with Eileen Ryan from my play, A Medal for Mary, and a visiting actress, Ephrat Levy, saw the scene, and she came up to me and she said, "I'm going back to Israel. Can I take your play?" And I said, "Sure." And I gave it to her. And the Bet Lesson Theater, who has been running for 30 years, they only do quality plays, bought it. And we went into negotiations for 2 months, and I signed a contract, and it's a hit.
That's great.
It's because you're a hit.
Yeah.
We're through.
I was going to ask some quick questions.
Ask questions. Well, actually, come join us up here.
Okay.
My
quick question to you, Peter, is as a writer, as an artist, what is it that you satisfy as a writer that is not necessarily satisfied as an actor?
Well, I'm a painter also.
Okay. Rub it in.
And the tactile immediacy of the painting satisfies me. And when I see a painting that I've done 15 years ago hanging on a wall, I said, I'm astounded. The writing, I don't like writing. it's a lonely solitude. It's another area of creativity.
Right.
And I have to gear myself to write. And when I gear myself, I produce. You know. And what was your question?
I think that covered it.
I have such an opportunity right now to switch that question. My question was, what is it that says, as an artist, what is it that satisfies you as a writer, and we found out that you were a painter as well, that doesn't necessarily satisfy you as an actor? Or is it a question that doesn't quite work because it's all satisfying to you? You don't like the act of writing, which is very lonely.
Well, I think as an actor, I think everyone who's interested in acting should take one writing class or understand exactly what writing is about, because you know many times actors today more than ever decide that they want to change the words that the writer writes. And that has nothing to do with interpretation or acting. A writer when a writer creates a character, that's it. And it is then the actor's job not to put their own writing spin on the character, but to interpret what that writer has created. Would you agree with that?
Yes. It calls to my mind, what was that show was directed by Bill Penn with
Thérèse Raccoon.
Thérèse Raccoon, which was a book by Emile Zola. It was adapted for television.
Play of the week.
Play of the week, the play of the week. And I was a leading man, and Eva Le Gallien was a fantastic actress and a director, and she was in the 20s and the 30s and the 40s, and Bill Penn, who was not related to Arthur Penn, asked me, because I was struggling with the dialogue. It was not lucid dialogue. He said, was knowing my writing ability. He said, will you write your dialogue and and I went home and I worked my ass off, and I didn't tell Eva Le Gallien and the cast that I was rewriting the denouement of the play, where she had a paroxysmal attack when she hears the murderer of her son, anyway, I wrote the second half of the play, and that was the went on the air, and I corroborated my feeling that I could write, you know, and.
Well, I mean, every artist, I think, has to understand every different aspect of creativity.
Yes.
Just like, it's the whole picture. There's a missing piece if you don't at least taste it all.
Well, as an actor, I say words, and under circumstances, put two people together, no matter what people and what walk of life their garage attendant and a young woman, what do they have in common? Well, people talk, and the garage mechanic had said, "Oh, you're picking up your car?" And she said, "No, I'm waiting for somebody." And what do they say?
Yeah.
And I talk the characters. And no matter, I tell my children who has writing ability, put disparate characters in the situation and have them talk, no matter what they said, and don't govern yourself. Talk, and see what happens.
That's fantastic
Amazing.
Advice. You know, it's interesting hearing you, because I'm not an actor, I'm a writer, okay? And artists, by their nature, are very sensitive. Whether you were talking before about seeing, you see the bridge of a nose, you see the eyelashes.
Yeah.
This is not necessarily something that someone who is not an artist will notice.
Yeah.
Okay. Writers are interior. Will sit in solitude and will compose, like somebody composes on a piano. And it has to be true to life. It has to sound real to be effective and to last. So I love listening to you. Because, seriously, because as an actor, you're showing me another level of artistry, and you're speaking for your soul, is how it's coming across to me. So thank you.
Yes, thank you very, very much, Peter, my good friend, Joel Eisenberg. Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight. I'm sure you can stick around, maybe take a couple of pictures of people if they wanted to get a photo with you, if you want to do that. And then Joel and I will be signing our books. Everyone, thank you. Next week, we have Cindy Williams and Larry Matthews, Little Richie from the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Diane. Thank you, Barnes & Noble.
Our pleasure.
By the way, as I was sitting there and I was listening to Peter, I don't know why it struck me, but the one television show from the 1950s that I forgot to mention before is The Adventures of Superman. I don't know why. I was listening
did
to
you
the
do that?
And I thought of The Adventures
did
of
Superman. Did you do Superman?
No, no, no. It just came to mind as a 1950s television program. Segway, I'm sorry.
Nice meeting you.
Very nice meeting you. I learned a lot from you.
Yes.
This is going to be up on YouTube.
Oh, it's good. Oh, okay, this is going to be on YouTube. Quando? When?
Soon.
Soon. So look for it.
Oh,
on What Up Hollywood, correct?
Yeah.
WhatUpHollywood.com as well. So Diane, thank you to Diane, everyone.
Thank you all for being here very much. Thank you.
You want to take pictures?
Okay.